This week we'll spend time with Lindy Burch, living legend in cutting, and we'll see her stunning Weatherford, Texas ranch. Then it's off to Fort Worth for a tour of the National Cowgirl Museum and Hall of Fame.
So get comfortable, kick your boots off, and join me. This is The Horse Show, and I'm Rick Lamb.
Studies have shown that the higher the body temperature, the quicker an athlete reaches fatigue. That's why pro football players use protective padding that's not only shock-absorbing, but lightweight and breathable to allow heat dissipation. Now the same technology is available for your horse. Professionals Choice Air Ride saddle pads are designed with exactly the same material, which allows your horse to remain cool and performing at its maximum while effectively deflecting shock. Try the Air Ride today. Go to profchoice.com and click Rick Lamb.
When customers talk, Richie listens. And the Omni 10 automatic waterer has just what customers want. Extra size and strength, total heat coverage, large access panel, stainless steel trough, and Richie's famous fast refill valve. Like all Richie waterers, the Omni 10 is durable, reliable, and comes with a 10-year warranty. Learn more at richiefount.com. And relax, Richie waters them right.
Weatherford, Texas is home to the first lady of cutting, Lindy Burch. She was the first woman to win the NCHA Futurity, the first female open world champion, and the first female president of the NCHA. She's a member of the National Cowgirls Hall of Fame and the NCHA Riders Hall of Fame. Her accomplishments are legendary, and she set records in cutting that have stood for decades.
When you're doing a run, when you're doing a cutting, is your mind active, or have you just kind of settled your mind?
I hope it is.
Really? Or what I was going to say is, do you kind of just relax your mind and kind of let your training and your instincts kind of take over at that point?
Both. I mean, I do things subconsciously that I can't even tell people, even in an advanced clinic that I give, how to do or when to do it. It's just like, I feel it. And you've heard 100 times
sure.
in what you do, and people that you've interviewed in the past, they'll say, well, I just felt it, or it's feel, or I can't explain it, Rick, it's feel. Cutting is all about feel, because it's a relationship. The horse is reading the cow's giving the signal off. I'm a passenger, but yet I'm not a passive passenger. I'm somewhat an active passenger, and how active and how precise and how correct I am and how close a partner I am with my horse, that will determine how good our run is.
Are you supporting the horse's decision, or are you giving input to the horse?
Supporting.
Because isn't that the idea behind cutting?
Is exactly.
That it's got to be the horse's choice as to how he moves.
I mean, when I train a horse from the get-go, from the very start, I'm putting him in a position to read and control the cow. But the cow's the teacher. I'm like the assistant teacher. I'm just here helping, but the cow's saying, no, I'm stopping here, so I got to stop my horse. Okay, I'm taking a step here. Here, take a step, horse. But I'm mimicking what that cow's telling him to do. And then as time goes on, the horse starts picking up more and more for the cow, relying less and less on me, positioning her, and then pretty soon a great horse then takes that next step up the ladder and says, okay, I think you're going to do this, and they anticipate that cow. And then that's what, I mean, in any other equine discipline, it can't compare, because the horse is reading the cow, is using the tools that I've helped them develop, but the horse is making the decisions, and the horse is doing it, and I have the best seat in the house. I'm sitting on the horse watching this contest between the horse and the cow, and the cow saying, trying to figure out where she's going to go, and the horse going, no, you're not. Like,
but you've got to kind of read the cow too, don't you?
Oh,
I mean,
definitely.
If the horse zigs and you zag, it's all over.
No.
I know that feeling.
Right.
So what is the difference between a really good rider in cutting and a not so good rider?
All riders have to have ability and agility. They have to have timing. A lot of great cutting horse riders do a lot, but it doesn't look like they're doing it. Meaning, I mean, it's more of a mental game than anything. But you're as you said, you have to read that cow so you can move with the horse without being in the way of the horse, and making the right thing easy for that horse. If she needs to jump over here to cover the cow over here, this leg's hanging there like a post. That horse is going, I can't quite get over there. But if I see that cow starting and I open up my leg, then that horse just go, whew, and just skit right in the spot. And then when she needs to stop, my legs have to just be out like a feather, so that horse, all she feels is the bottom of that ground and my weight sinking down on her back. If I sit up there stiff and I go to that stop and I'm braced up and I'm standing up in those stirrups, that horse is gonna say, oh, I gotta keep going here. My inertia makes that horse go take that extra step.
Yeah.
Which in cutting, if she takes an extra step here, that cow says, oh, there's my hole. Turns, and then my horse is behind, and we have a miss or we lose the cow.
You haven't always been a cutter. I mean, when you were a kid, you were like every other kid. You just loved to go out and ride.
Well, that's true. I had horses like most kids have bikes.
Yeah.
And I had a bike, but I didn't use it very much. I rode everywhere. And I grew up in Southern California, where one day a week we had kind of, I don't even, cowboy day or something. It was really a casual day, but we were allowed to ride our horses to school.
To school. Oh,
and there was a barn right next to the school. And, you know, we didn't have a stall or anything. We'd tie them up, probably, I guess, all day. I don't remember now. But we just rode. And I rode and rode and rode every day. And rode with my dad on the weekends. He was a machinist. He wasn't a trainer or a cowboy, like a full-time cowboy. So on the weekends, we went somewhere. Everywhere. Saturday was our day to ride. Sunday was our day that we got in the car and had to take a ride in the car with Mom.
Family time.
But in the summer, I was riding every day from sun up till sundown.
And you were off out by yourself.
Most of the time, I mean, from time to time, I remember having little gangs, you know, kids my age that rode, that wanted to ride like I did. And luckily, when I was young, I had the paint. I had a pinot. So I was always the Indian, and, you know, cowboys and Indians.
Cowboys
so and they were, they had to chase me and find me, and it was really great because I could, you know, I always knew the good places to hide. And
what I meant by going out on your own, sometimes your mom would be worried about you, right?
Always.
But you got to tell the story about the homing pigeons.
Okay, we lived in L.A. at the time, and that, I mean, it's not like L.A. is now. It was a little bit more country, but we lived around Van Nuys, and they had a huge wash. Would empty all the water out, I guess, when it rained. But it was a deep place that nobody would go to. And a lot of country where you could ride all day there. So that's what we would do. But my mom would not let me go out and stay out all day by myself. And she says, well, you can phone. I said, I can't phone because there's no phone booths. She says, well, then you come back every 3 hours and check in, then you can go back out again. Well, I did that for a day or two, and that wasn't going to work for me. I didn't like that. Because when I'd leave in the morning, I'd pack a lunch, and I'd have my canteen water, and I'm off. I'm gone all day. And so I devised this system where I would get my homing pigeons. My dad built me a big homing pigeon cage. I had like 50 pairs at one time. I had a lot of pigeons. So I had saddlebags. I'd carry the pigeons. My dad built a little pigeon cage.
So you just stuff the pigeons in the saddlebag?
In my saddlebags. And I had bands. I had a little envelope with bands in them and a little notepad and a pen. So I'd stuff like 4 or 5 in each saddlebag. And my dad built this little coop by the kitchen window of our house. And they'd fly in and the little wires would open up so there'd be a one-way door and the pigeons would fly in, or the pigeon. After I banded it, I'd write where I was. Okay, it's 11 o'clock, here I am, I'm fine. And don't worry, Lindy, you know, send it back. And my mom would put this long asbestos kitchen glove on because she was really afraid to hold a bird.
She was kind of scared of animals in general.
A little bit, yeah. And she was a great woman, very brave, a wonderful woman, you know, but she just wasn't very horsey. And she sure didn't want to hold a pigeon.
Or pigeony, for that matter.
It wasn't pigeony. She loved dogs and cats, so that was about it with her. So she'd get this kitchen glove on, and she'd reach into this cage, and this cage is only like about 1 foot by 2 foot, so the pigeons couldn't get away, thank God. They'd get in there, and she'd squish them down, and then she'd reach in there and grab the band, you know, like this, and she'd let the pigeon go, and open it up and read my note. And then I'd have another 3 hours, here'd come another pigeon, she'd have to go through the whole thing again. Now, if I failed to send the pigeon home, then. Uh-oh. She was on, yeah, I was in really
But
real
she had
trouble.
Some people she could call.
She was in real trouble. Fortunately or unfortunately, I come from a family of policemen, it seems like, and my brother is still a policeman. My dad was the captain of the Mounted Police, Chino Mounted Police, and my mom worked as a dispatcher for the police department for years. So whenever I was in trouble, which wasn't very often, but I would from time to time play hooky and do a few things I shouldn't, always had to do with horses, it seemed like. But if I didn't show up, she'd get on the phone and here'd come squad cars, or my mother, or the worst thing was my mother coming in the station wagon down the road. If I saw her coming, what are you going to say? You can't lie to your mother.
So that really happened? She had to come out and chase you down?
It's happened quite a few times. And then I'd be restricted for a week or two, but usually I'd talk her out of it and I'd be gone again, you know.
Coming up next, more with Lindy Burch and the National Cowgirl Museum. Plus another nutrition nugget from ADM Alliance Nutrition.
It's a physiological thing.
Stay with us.
We have to look at their teeth.
Go wild. Go super wild. Fly protection goes high fashion with the Super Mask 2 Horsefly Mask with Shimmerweave Mesh. Shimmerweave Mesh reflects your horse's natural color. Choose from four fabulous fashion-forward styles. Go wild with the Super Mask 2 Horsefly Mask with Shimmerweave Mesh Color Collection.
And the main brand that I only remember was Red Brand. And I can vouch for you, that's what this wire is. And it was put up sometime in 1933 and early for 34. There used to be an old saying made by Red Brand: horse high, bull stout, and hog tight.
I was looking for a riding buddy, and ACLA helped me find one.
Debbie used ACLA's Find a Buddy program.
Nobody wants to ride alone. Find a Buddy is a great way to share the fun of trail riding and build a riding community.
Find a Buddy is a free service from ACLA. Membership is not required. Visit ACTHA.US.
So, find a buddy.
And let's ride.
Build community with the American Competitive Trail Horse Association. ACTHA.US. Imagine a warehouse with everything for your horse. That's Jeffers Equine. Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same-day free shipping, the happiest customers, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Save big on a year's supply of apple-flavored dewormers, just $29.99. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com to get your free catalog. Equine specialists are standing by. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
Saturday was our day to ride. Sunday was family day, and we got in the car and we drove all around the country. So we were driving in Ojai, of all places, one day, and there were a bunch of horse trailers, and my dad just automatically pulls in there, and a cutting show was going on. So I said, "What's that?" And he says, "It's a cutting." So we hung out and sat on the fence for a couple hours and watched this cutting. And we got back in that car, and I said, "That is what I'm going to do." And my dad said, "You know what? That'd be great if you wanted to." And I said, "That's what I'm going to do. I'm going to cut." And it was either that week or the next week. It was very soon after that. In moves a guy in a blue, baby blue Dodge pickup that said, "Bruce Cahill, cutting horse trainer, Lynn Haven, Kansas." He moves in across the road. So, boy, I sprint right across the road and announce that I'd like to
Help him out a little bit.
Help him out. He says, "Okay, I'll teach you to cut."
You put in a tremendous amount of effort to get where you are today to accomplish all of this. And, of course, the ranch that we're standing at right now just blows me away. I mean, it is so beautiful. Will you show us around a little bit and tell us about it?
I'd love to.
Okay, great. Where do we start?
This is Beth. This is the apple of my eye right here.
Now, is she retired from performing?
She is. She's been retired since the end of 2000. Well, actually, 2001 was the last time I got to cut on her. She's 17, if you can believe it.
Boy, beautiful.
That's the mare I won the world on, and I marked at 233. And she's the greatest open mare I've ever seen, and most people have ever seen.
So was that your deal with her? You win me this one, and you get to retire?
You know, I wanted to let her retire when she was on top.
Yeah.
I didn't want her to get sore. She'd done so much for me, and she's such a great horse that I didn't want her to get sore or look bad, you know, in the arena. And she has such a great reputation, and she got to retire as the world champion and a great reputation. I thought that was the least I could do for her.
We took a look at some of the other horses in Lindy's breeding program, including some good-looking youngsters. And her fine roan breeding stallion, Bet On Me 498. By the legendary Smart Little Lena, and out of Lindy's champion mare, Bet Your Blue Boons. Then it was off to the house.
The 80 Ranch.
The 80 Ranch, do you know where that came from?
No.
Perfect Score and Cutting.
Oh, of course, mm-hmm. Of course.
But you know, when I first moved in, and I love the house the way I first designed it, there's another spare room in there. My bedroom's upstairs where I can see all around, no curtains anywhere, so I can see everywhere. And I have a little office up here. But you know, as you live outside and you live on a ranch, there's always things to do. You know, I think I usually have one project each year I do.
It's hard to imagine anyone more down-to-earth and likable than Lindy. And it's easy to see why she loves her life.
Oh boy, what a beautiful view from your front porch here.
Thanks.
I am so jealous. What a place. Well, thank you so much for sharing the Lindy Burch story with us so far. I know there's a lot more.
Another time, a lot more chapters.
Yeah, well, thank you so much.
Thank you, thanks for coming.
And good luck in the cutting tomorrow.
I appreciate it, okay. I need it, I'll take it.
Take
Bye-bye.
Care.
I'm in Fort Worth, Texas today at the National Cowgirl Museum and Hall of Fame. Now, this is the only museum in the world that honors and documents the lives of women who encompass the pioneer spirit. Now, these women of the American West set an example for all women today who aspire to be courageous and self-confident and self-reliant. There are 181 women in the Hall of Fame, with more being added each year. Let's go inside and meet some of them. The museum is as impressive as the women it honors. It's colorful, clean, and beautiful. Some of the exhibits are simple, some are high-tech and interactive, but they all grab you, draw you in. It's easy to lose track of time here. This is one place you can take the whole family, and everyone will find something that fascinates them.
All right, I'm here with DJ Latham, who is the public relations manager for the National Cowgirl Museum and Hall of Fame. He's going to give us a little bit of a tour. DJ, what you got for us?
Even though the National Cowgirl Museum and Hall of Fame is here in Fort Worth, Texas, you know, cowgirls really traveled all across, you know, America, and they're really a rich piece of American history. That's really the reason why the museum's here, is to kind of tell those untold stories of the women. And one of our gallery pieces here is really this, you know, on the road exhibit. This kind of shows a lot of the past and present rodeos, you know, that a lot of the cowgirls, you know, traveled to. You know, being on the road was a lot about friends and family. You know, they traveled together. It was just this, you know, collection of people that shared history together. What people can do here, they can actually sit on a tailgate here and listen to, you know, our honorees, you know, women such as, you know, Pam Minnick or Mitzi Riley, just about their experiences, about what life for them was like on the road, their trials or tribulations, and of course their triumphs as well.
Want to try riding a bucking bronco? You can.
Well, this is an incredible photograph. There's got to be a great story behind that.
Yeah, there actually is. Bonnie McCarroll, she's actually one of our 2006 honorees. We inducted her last year. She was famous bronc rider, and she was, you know, really tremendous. This is actually one, if not the most publicized rodeo images ever in history. She was actually at the Pendleton Roundup on a horse named Silver when she was thrown off. Now, ironically, she actually died from a result of, you know, injuries when she was ever at Pendleton a few years later.
Well, here's another great picture. There's got to be a story behind this one, too.
Well, yeah, and again, it shows a lot of our, you know, several of our honorees here. So this is a picture from, you know, the 20s of a group of cowgirls that was actually heading over to Europe. They were really celebrities in their own right. I mean, these women were known, well-known celebrities in the States. And so, of course, you know, the word had spread over across, you know, the sea. And so they went over and they performed for dignitaries, for kings and queens. And so here they are, you know, just very excited to be on their way.
Now, we're celebrating here the pioneering spirit which is not only rodeo cowgirls.
Exactly, Rick. We actually here have more than 180 women honored in our Hall of Fame, and they range from artists to musicians to, you know, rodeo cowgirls to ranchers. We're actually standing in front of Sandra Day O'Connor's book. You know, the retired Justice O'Connor actually was inducted in 2002. She was born in El Paso, and she grew up on a cattle ranch in Arizona, so not a lot of people know about her Western roots. There's women like Sacagawea, who led the, you know, Lewis and Clark expedition, women like Laura Ingalls Wilder, you know, that...
Little House on the Prairie.
Exactly, Little House on the Prairie. Patsy Cline, also just, you know, George O'Keefe, you know, the wonderful artist.
And they become an inspiration to everybody that follows.
Exactly, and we induct new women annually, and we're continuing to do that very strong.
Well, thank you so much for the tour, well, DJ.
Thank you for being here. We really appreciate it much.
And now, Nutrition Nuggets, brought to you by ADM Alliance Nutrition.
What do we need to know about feeding older horses? I'm with Dr. Judy Reynolds, equine nutritionist, ADM Alliance Nutrition. Dr. Reynolds, what about the seniors?
Well, you know, horses are living longer all the time. They're living into their 30s. They're trusted old companions. We love them all. And there's no set time, calendar-wise, that we'd call a horse a senior. It's a physiological thing. And what happens is, at a certain point in time, they don't do as well in the same feeding program that they've had. Somewhere when they're 14, 18, 22, there's that time where they don't do as well. That's what we're going to talk about as a senior horse. We have to look at their teeth. The teeth are extremely important. They break down all these long-stem forages into tiny little pieces that can be swallowed. If those teeth don't work correctly, we have to do that for the horse. This is why we do things like mashes and pelleted feeds and things for senior horses, because we're really replacing those teeth. So key things with those older horses, got to do a medical exam, check the teeth and figure out what's going on with them, and then we're going to put the package of feeds together for them. Okay, they're going to need a little more protein. They may need some vitamin C because they don't make it as well anymore, and some other extra vitamins. We're going to want, again, a lower starch. We don't want the grains because they're hard to digest, so we're going to want fats and fibers in the feed. They may do all right on pasture and 6 pounds of a good feed. They may have to have complete feed that is 100% pelleted, 18 to 20 pounds or that kind of thing. But we just have to look at each one as an individual. There are a lot of great senior feeds out there. Really important, though, if you buy a feed that you're supposed to feed 20 pounds of, you don't want to feed 5 pounds of that.
All right, Dr. Reynolds, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
To learn more about ADM Alliance Nutrition, visit growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com.
In the coming months, Rick will appear at these events, and he'd like to meet you. Up-to-the-minute details are available at thehorseshow.com. Thehorseshow.com is also a great way to listen to Rick's radio shows or buy signed copies of his books. There's something new for horse lovers every week at thehorseshow.com.
Horses need grain.
Not true. Research has shown that equine grain-associated disorders can be a threat to domestic horses. That's why Glow for Life feeds from ADM Alliance Nutrition go against the grain with premium low-starch, high-fat, high-fiber formulations to feed horses the way they're meant to eat, for life. For a limited time, get a free customized feeding plan for your horse at growstrong.com. That's growstrong.com. Studies have shown that the higher the body temperature, the quicker an athlete reaches fatigue. That's why pro football players use protective padding that's not only shock-absorbing, but lightweight and breathable to allow heat dissipation. Now the same technology is available for your horse. Professionals Choice Air Ride saddle pads are designed with exactly the same material, which allows your horse to remain cool and performing at its maximum while effectively deflecting shock. Try the Air Ride today. Go to profchoice.com and click Rick Lamb.
When customers talk, Richie listens. And the Omni 10 automatic waterer has just what customers want. Extra size and strength, total heat coverage, large access panel, stainless steel trough, and Richie's famous fast refill valve. Like all Richie waterers, the Omni 10 is durable, reliable, and comes with a 10-year warranty. Learn more at richiefount.com. And relax, Richie waters them right.
Next week, we're in Durango, Colorado, not to ski, but to have a fine cowboy hat custom made from beginning to end. using time-honored tools, a heavy dose of creativity, and plenty of modern know-how.
So have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time. For The Horse Show, I'm Rick Land.
She's in the bucket.
Oh, she's in the bucket.
Closed captioning is presented by Muddy Creek Rain Gear. Lightweight, breathable, and truly waterproof. Visit muddycreek.net.